All right, so then for chapter 9, we're just going to do one example, but we are going to do one example of these statics problems that we have, where again we're trying to balance out both the forces and the torques. We're going to do a rather longer one, that'll kind of show us a lot of different properties of these different problems, right? So we only need to do one of these, but it'll kind of show you pretty much everything you need to know about all the different problems I could come up with to ask you. So we have is this problem here. We have a car driving across a drawbridge, right? And so we're all show you exactly what we're given here at the beginning. We're going to say we're given the mass and the positions of the car, the mass of the bridge. Then we also are given the position of where the cable is attached to this bridge. What we're going to do is find the tension in the cable and the force of this hinge. Let's first of all, before we put any numbers to this, let's draw all of our forces onto this diagram, and then we'll figure out which ones are then going to apply torques, which will allow us to set up our equations and solve for our variables. So the first force that we have obviously is this force of this car, right? It's going to be pulling down on this bridge, right? So we're going to have some force acting here. Say it's the mass of the car times gravity, right? So we also have the tension in this cable. This is another obvious one. This cable here is acting in this direction with some tension T. We actually also do know the angle of this, so I'll fill that in. We've got 40 degrees there. So these are two of our forces. We actually have two more, though. We also have the center of mass of the bridge, which we're going to say, I'll put a number to it here in a second, but we're going to say that it is right about here. So the center of mass of the bridge, the car's in the middle of the bridge, the center of mass of the bridge is actually not in the center. We have this counterweight on the other side, so the center of mass is closer over here. The car's in the middle, the cable's at the end, and then there's one more force that we have to account for. There is the force of this hinge itself, right? So if we are going to have this be in static equilibrium, we don't know the exact angle of this force, but we do know it has to be pulling up, right? You know, this bridge is kind of trying to fall down, but this cable is actually pulling it both up and to the left. So it's going to be this hinge that's holding it up, but also actually pushing it slightly to the right. So we don't know what this angle is, and we don't know what the strength of that force is. So this is the mass of the bridge, this is the mass of the car. Let's go ahead, let's start putting numbers to some of these. So we have the mass of the bridge is going to be 2,500 kilograms. The mass of the car is going to be 900 kilograms. We have the distance to the center of mass of the bridge. I'm going to call it R sub b. So this distance here is going to be 1.5 meters. The distance to the car is then 4.5 meters. And so when we do that, we also have the, let me make sure I get my numbers right, the distance to the where this cable is all the way across the bridge, right? This car is halfway across. I'm going to call it R sub t. This distance, the distance to the very end of the bridge where the cable is attached, is going to be 9 meters, right? So these are the values that we're given, right? We know everything there is to know about the bridge and the car, and what we want to know is we want to find this T, find this F, and find this theta, right? We want to know everything there is to know about this force from the hinge. So we have four different forces, and we're going to need to figure out how we want to set this problem up to write our equation. We're actually going to have three equations this time. We're going to have to balance out the forces in the x direction, in the y direction, and then, of course, our torques trying to rotate this drawbridge, right? Let's go ahead and write our forces first, and then we'll deal with this idea of our torques, right? So there's a little trick that we're going to do to kind of make our torque equation a little bit easier on ourselves. But for now, let's just write our x and y equations for our forces. So if I sum up all my forces in the x direction, what I get is this. So neither the mass of the bridge nor the mass of the car are acting in the x direction. However, the hinge and the tension force are. So in the x direction, we have forces to the right equal the forces to the left. We have F times cosine of theta must be equal to T times cosine of 40. All right, sorry about that. So we have our forces in the x direction, right? We have f cosine theta equals t cosine of 40. So again, just the forces to the right are equaling out the forces to the left. So we now sum up our forces in the y direction, right? So our forces basically pulling this bridge up have to be equal to our forces pulling this bridge down. So in this case, we would then say this, the forces going up, well, both the hinge and tension are pulling this bridge up. So we'd say f sine of theta, right, for the vertical component of F, plus t times sine of 40 must be equal to mass of the bridge times acceleration due to gravity plus mass of the car times the acceleration due to gravity, right? The forces up have to be equal to the forces going down. So now we've balanced out our forces, and now, so this is kind of what we're used to. We've done this part before, but now we need to balance out these torques, right? So we have to sum up all of our torques and see what we get. So we are going to have different forces here. Some of them are going to be trying to spin the bridge this way. Some of them are going to be trying to spin the bridge this way. We're going to have to see exactly which ones are doing what. So the first thing we have to do, though, is we have to pick our pivot point for this bridge, right? So as I said before, if our object is actually rotating, right, like if you're actually, you know, opening a door, if this drawbridge were actually spinning in some way, then you'd have to pick the pivot point to be the actual hinge that it's rotating about. In this case, though, this bridge is in static equilibrium, right? It's not moving, it's not rotating, right? So there's no acceleration or anything happening, right? So this is a nice statics case that we have. So when you actually have an object that is in static equilibrium, it is actually valid to pick the pivot point anywhere along that object, right? It has to be somewhere on the object, right? It can't pivot about some other point off of the object, obviously, but any point along here is actually counted as a valid pivot point because it's not actually pivoting, right? There's no actual rotation occurring. So you will get a different torque equation, but it'll actually still all balance out depending on, as long as you pick your point and set up all of your distances correctly, right? So in this case, actually, I still do want to pick this point, this hinge point here, right? Again, this is my choice, but the reason I want to do this is because I don't know much about this force F. However, if I pick the pivot point here, right where the hinge is exerting its force, then I will not have this force show up in my torque equation, right? So that'll make my equations a little bit easier to work with. I'll have fewer unknowns. Let's go ahead and do that. So here's my pivot point here. So let's now set my clockwise torques equal to my counterclockwise torque. So the mass of the bridge and the mass of the car trying to pull this bridge down, right? Whereas this rope is pretty much what we have trying to spin the bridge back up this way, making sure it doesn't do that. So what we can say is this. We have the R of the bridge times mass of the bridge times gravity plus the distance to the car times the mass of the car times gravity. In this case, this is easy for us because these two are both just perpendicular, right? So the R vector would be from here to here. The force is exerted this way. So this is a 90 degree angle. So sine of 90 is 1, so we don't have to worry about it. We just have R times F. And as for this case as well, then this must be equal to the torque being exerted by this cable here. So this would be equal to this. We would say is equal to RT times T times the sine of 40, right? So T sine of 40 is just the vertical component of this. Essentially, we're saying the vertical component of this force is the only component of the force that is going to be exerting a torque. Okay, so then with this, what we have is these equations here, right? So again, what we're looking for is theta, F, and T. So this does give us three equations and three unknowns. Good news for us, we did make it a little bit easier on ourselves. Remember, we picked this as our pivot point. My torque equation doesn't have this F show up in it. Actually, in this torque equation, good thing to recognize right away, I know everything there is to know in this equation except for this T. So right away, I can make this easy on myself and just do it to two equations and two unknowns by solving for this T. So I can do my algebra, and my T will be equal to RB mass of the bridge, distance to the bridge times gravity plus distance to the car, mass of the car times gravity divided by RT sine of 40. If you plug all these numbers in, right, we know the distance is 1.5 meters. These are 2,500 kilograms. This is 9.8, obviously. RC, right, the distance to the car is halfway across the bridge. Mass of the car is 900. We know gravity. We know the distance to the end of the bridge, this 9 meters here. So when we plug all this in, what we get is a tension force of about 13,200 newtons, right? Now with this, we can use these two equations to go back and we can solve for our F, Right, we can solve for f and theta, right? So now we are down to two equations and two unknowns that we have solved for this t. So I'll look at this x equation first, and what I get is something that looks like this. I have f is going to be equal to t cosine of 40 divided by cosine of theta. So now I just need to plug this in to my other equation here, right? So we'll plug this f in. This will then give me what I'll have t cosine of 40 divided by cosine of theta times sine of theta plus t sine of 40 equals mg plus mcg, right? So again, I'm just we've used our torque equation. We figure out what this t is. Now we can just use these two equations and solve for the theta and the f. Here's the f in terms of theta. Plug that in for where the f goes. Now we have this. We just have one equation, one unknown. We just have to solve for this theta. So what we end up with is tangent of theta, right? Sine over cosine is tangent. So tangent of theta is going to be equal to mbg plus cg divided by, whoops, hold on, I missed a term, minus t, bring this over, t sine of 40, then divided by t cosine of 40. So when you do this, right, and then you obviously take the inverse tangent of all of this stuff, what you end up with is, run out of room here, that's okay, we're almost done. We end up with an angle of about 68 degrees. With this, I can then plug this back into here. I know that the force exerted by this hinge will be about 27,000 newtons, right? So again, summarizing everything that we had, right? We had four different forces acting on this bridge: the hinge, the mass of the bridge, the mass of the car driving across it, and then the tension in the cable. We knew this. We need to make sure that this bridge is in a static equilibrium case, right? You don't want your bridge falling into the water as you try to drive over it or anything like that. We set up our equations, right? We have to balance out the force in the x direction, balance out the force in the y direction, and balance out our tension with this, right? Since I picked the right pivot point, any pivot point will work. But again, picking the right pivot point can make things a little bit easier on you, right? You can eliminate one of these forces that you don't know much about, so it doesn't show up in your tension in your torque equation, right? That allows us to find the tension very easily. Once we have the tension, then it's relatively simple to find both the strength of the force and the direction of the force, right? 27,000 newton force up at this 68 degree angle.